So, good evening, and thank you all for coming. Thanks to Carol for the lovely introduction. Thank you to Deborah Bremer, Arlen Ode, Stephen Lynn Marcus, John Shannon, everybody for making all of this possible. And also, you know, Sculpture Milwaukee bringing all this many quality sculptures to that town of Milwaukee is a remarkable and wonderful accomplishment. So, this evening, I am charged with talking about the sculpture of a suit. Or, to be more exact, half a suit. Half a suit. Erwin Wurm's half-big suit from 2016 is an unconventional, and doubly so, it is an unconventional interpretation of a piece of figurative sculpture, and it's an unconventional interpretation of a piece of what a suit is in the popular imagination. However, as we all know, unconventionality can only be properly put into context by defining conventionality. So let's get started on defining figurative sculpture and what constitutes a suit, the epitome of a suit, and what that should look like in a conventional way. So let's start with what a suit should look like. And here we have, quite possibly, the greatest suit of all time. 1959, Cary Grant, North by Northwest, suit by Kilgore, French and Stanbury of Savile Row in London. Basically, it is apparently they used 16 suits in the suit, so there must be stumped suits. And I always feel the credits for this movie should be Cary Grant, Eva Marie Saint, James Mason, Cary Grant's suit. And Eva Marie Saint's wardrobe was pretty fantastic too. And if that is not enough, then how about Sean Connery Goldfinger, 1964, suit by Anthony Sinclair, lovely creepy suit. If that's not your taste, then William Steve McQueen and Thomas Crabbe Fair, 1968, suit by Harry Hayward, who also did the suits for Michael Caine, Peter Carter, 1971. And then last but not least, we have Robert Redford in The Great Gatsby, 1974, suit by Theodore. But in these movies, with these actors, the suit is more than just a prop or a costume, but it's very much intrinsic to the character being portrayed. The suits become more than clothing, they become symbolic of the character's personality, and I think it's fair to say that in all five instances, the characters carry themselves with a certain aplomb, their job, and their self-image that they wish to project. But these visual benchmarks aside, a suit. What is it? It's an item. It's a noun defined by dictionary.com as one, a set of clothing, armor, or the like intended for wear together. Two, a set of men's garments of the same color and fabric consisting of trousers, a jacket, and sometimes a vest. It's also an adjective, which is often really more of a pejorative, a suit, defined as an executive, manager, or official, especially one regarded as a faceless decision. A suit is also someone in business, especially perhaps when compared with an artist or an ordinary worker. Quote, the network suits don't care about the fans who show up at the ballpark. But it can also be a work of art, as Joseph Wise did with his felt suit in 1970. But it is something more. To go back to these dictionary definitions, it's metaphorically a suit of armor. It's a signifier of occupation and state. To wear one is to acknowledge something, that you're going to work in a particular profession or going to something that requires more formal attire. It's not necessarily dress up, but it is, particularly more and more these days, that you are or are doing something out of the ordinary. And even in the movies, the donning of a suit is a sartorial shorthand to convey the message that the wearer is engaged in something serious and professional. John Belushi and Dan Aykroyd are looking to raise money to save their ponies. And this is really freaky. I kid you not, when I came into the hotel tonight, this movie was playing on the TV. Men in Black, Tommy Lee Jones, Will Smith trying to stop aliens sealing super energy stores called the Galaxy. Or Reservoir Dogs. Six criminals hired to do a diamond robbery are given color-coded names, but they all wear black suits. One is possibly an informal, but in these movies, a suit suggests and implies professionalism. Serious work requires serious clothing. Clothing inevitably comes with interpretations and assumptions. So it requires assumptions, and so given the fact that they function a suit of armor, when we're talking about the movies, what actors wear is carefully calibrated, researched, and selected. In real life, the decision to wear a suit is obviously much more personal. To wit, in the 1980s, Milwaukee photographer Tom Bamberger took pictures of Milwaukee's titans of industry wearing what else but a suit. For these men of their generation, to wear anything other than a suit for business was unthinkable. A suit was their uniform, and the better the suit, the more powerful presence it exuded. So here's B.J. Sampson from 1984, Sheldon Lubar, and Helen Keller. However, British artist Grayson Perry takes a different interpretation. As he wrote in his book, The Descent of Man, quote, "A primary function of their sober attire is not just to look smart, but to be invisible. The business suit is the uniform of those who do the looking, the appraising, which rebuffs it, comment by its sheer ubiquity." But Perry's remark is contentious. Certainly a man in a suit doesn't look smart, and he may well blend into the point of invisibility and ubiquity in certain environments. And the relevance and appropriateness of environment that showcases what a suit means is what we're looking at with Edward Wurm's sculpture. However, as Deborah Bremer presented at Milwaukee's Portrait Society Gallery in 2009 in an exhibition of photographs by Nicholas Greider, a suit represents something. This was the last movie clip I was going to show you. We have Pulp Fiction from 1997, Jules Vincent are doing business. They are dressed smartly in suits. Here, can we take them seriously? So, Nicholas Ryder does a series called Men in Suits. Numerous men, there are actually three women photographed, numerous men photographed in their own homes using natural light wearing suit. And when Nicholas was asked if he saw clothing as a metaphor for armor or men doing battle in some way, Nicholas replied, quote, "I'm not sure about armor, but I think the suit is definitely the kind of civilian uniform. Even given great variety, a suit is still a suit. A relatively conservative outfit that most adult men own and that is attached to certain professions, like lawyer or businessman, or certain events, like weddings and funerals. It has the effect of making men more similar to each other, which is why details like the choice of shirt, tie, things like the pocket square and tie bars are there to reflect individuality." And in his photographs, Ryder's subjects were at ease in their own homes, wearing clothing normally associated with the work environment, thus raising the issue of what a suit conveys and where a suit is appropriate. Had they been taken in an office or a place of work, their clothing choice would carry different connotations, but in a domestic environment, the line becomes blurry, this juxtaposition more jarring. Why is a man wearing a suit at all? This challenges our interpretations, our stereotypes, and assumptions of when a suit is appropriate and when and where it should be worn. A suit, while it can be regarded as that metaphorical suit of armor, or even a uniform of sorts, can often be seen as a safety blanket, a sartorial safe. Back in the day when I was a lowly bank teller at Greenock in the 1980s, I wore a suit every day. There were no options. There was no casual Fridays. No wear your own street clothes from any charitable location. No sport coats. Suit, collar, tie, every day. It was mandatory. If memory serves me well, I had a dark grey wool suit with a grey pinstripe one. Unfortunately, but the dress code, of course, while it may seem constricting, we actually had to wear a bank-issued tie just in case any male employee had wild ideas about accepting our individuality. In retrospect, it wasn't such a bad thing. The bank manager could sleep safely at night knowing male employees would show up in a very presentable state. Believe it or not, female employees actually had most of their wardrobe, their upper wardrobe, provided. They had a blouse, they had a scarf, a sweater, and believe it or not, they even had a bank issued sweater vest that they had to wear. But for many men, some kind of sartorial regulation isn't just recommended, but positively a blessing. For many men, not all of them, I should hasten to add, the relaxed formality of work and casual Fridays present a sartorial nightmare. Socks or no socks, jeans, sports jerseys, t-shirts, sandals and socks, shorts, chest hair, how many buttons should be buttoned? The possible list of sartorial malfeasance is almost endless. Hence, the suit becomes the safe option, the default that assures some kind of respectability. And rarely does this find such perfect illustration in politics. Tony Blair, in a suit, on the left, he looks great. Cock and walk, king of the hill, brimming with youthful self-confidence. He's wearing a suit. On the left is a rather famous picture of when Tony Blair visited George W. Bush at Camp David. So, of course, all of a sudden you're into uncertain territory. It's Camp David, it's the weekend, it's casual, a suit is not appropriate, what do you wear? Tony obviously wants to retain that youthful, hip, young British Prime Minister thing. I don't want to wear those saggy, baggy dad jeans. But he goes too far in the opposite direction. He wears jeans so tight he can't get his hands in the pockets. This example is mild. Blair was Prime Minister, and certain standards were to be expected, if not actually met. On the other hand, there was one Alexander Boris de Pethel Johnson, former Mayor of London, currently Mayor, Member of Parliament for Royce of Uxbridge, and until recently the British Foreign Minister, which is basically equivalent to the Secretary of State. Here we have a picture of Boris Johnson in a perfectly acceptable, casual business suit. As you should point out, this is actually a photograph of a cardboard cutout of Boris Johnson. And in fact, this is actually very, very representational, because if anybody knows anything about British politics, Boris Johnson, a cardboard cutout, has a width, it has height, but just like the real Boris Johnson, it doesn't have a great deal of depth. But now, as is often common these days, you know, when you, even if you listen to NPR, they often, you know, for the right to do a story, they issue a trigger warning. And I should issue you a trigger warning for the next image, which more than makes my point about the suit being the safe option for men. You ready? This is what happens when you let certain shed that safety blanket of sin. It kind of leaves you feeling queasy. So, after this sartorial atrocity, let's return to civilization and admit that when it comes right down to it, the men's suit is basically the equivalent of women's little black dress. So, we will return to civilization after that sartorial nightmare, Boris Johnson with Audrey Hepburn and Carrie with a black dress and a perfect men's suit. But let's not dwell on the 20th, 21st centuries. The suit, as I've said, can be referred to as a kind of uniform. Throughout history, men have worn uniforms, whether it be military or in a more metaphorical sense, everyday business wear. And in fact, here's a picture from World War I, recruits lining up to enlist, and basically every single man in this picture is wearing a suit. The only thing that really differentiates them, and it's kind of interesting, it really kind of differentiates them by class, is their headwear. You have down the front, you've got bowler hat, then you've got various kind of, then you've got the boater, then you've got various kind of flat caps. And really, this would have almost been a kind of self-imposed class hierarchy. You would have known where a man stood on kind of social hierarchy by not so much what they were wearing, they're all wearing suits, but by their headwear. And throughout history, figures of sculptures often be a marker, a bellwether of sartorial selections and style. So here we have Greek Kouros. Of course, this was made before suits were even invented. But I have to say, if I had those abs, then I probably would wear a great deal of clothing either. So after we get past the Kouros, then of course, the first equivalent of a business suit was, of course, the toga. the suit of antiquity. Then we move into the 16th century, Michelangelo's David, again, quite a physique like that, with a great deal of clothes either. And here we have a sculpture that is actually here in Milwaukee. There is a sculpture of Robert Burns, and it's located less than a mile actually from Edward Wurm's sculpture, right up just following Wisconsin Avenue as it turns into Prospect up there in Burns Commons. And you know, Burns is wearing what would be kind of regarded as the normal fashion of the day back in the 18th century. But what you've actually kind of got here with these two sculptures of Edward Wurm and Robert Burns is within a mile of each other, the other kind of classic example of unconventional figurative sculpture, an incredibly conventional figurative sculpture. Here's Sir Ian, here's James Audubon as well. He's in George Square in Glasgow. He's in the 19th century. And you know, you've got the formal topcoat, you've got the top hat, you've got the cane. And for those for your information, James Audubon Oswald was actually a Scottish merchant and member of Parliament. I went to college in Glasgow. I've been to George Square many times, and I didn't know who he was. Now here we have a very much contemporary statue of a figurative statue wearing a suit. This is actually a sculpture right at the top of Buchanan Street in Glasgow. It's one of the main north-south shopping streets in the city. This is Donald Gira, who was the inaugural First Minister in Scotland. Basically, when Scotland got a lot of devolved powers, it got the First Minister, and Donald Gira was the First Minister. And he died in office in 2000, so they erected a sculpture in his honour at the top of Buchanan Street. On, of course, a very formal, serious plinth. And then you can see the scale here, it is larger than life size. Even though that plinth looks very smooth and very kind of unassailable, it does regularly get this. So that's normal. Donald likes to dress appropriately for the season, whether it's a tam shanter, a scarf, or in traditional Glasgow fashion, he wears a traffic code on his head. And actually, there's another sculpture in Glasgow. It's a huge equestrian sculpture of Wellington, the Napoleonic era general. So there's an enormous plinth and a horse, and then Wellington's a double horse. And I swear to God, every time I go to Glasgow, Wellington is a traffic code. these two sculptures are not exactly out of the way where nobody's, I mean, this is like, say, Burton's Commons, where you could probably sneak around at night or something. These are both basically on the equivalent of the Wisconsin Avenue. So you know, suddenly something that manages to scale up the slippery, smooth-sided plinth and put a traffic cone on top of his head. Well, what I've just shown you are serious monuments to people of significant accomplishments fashioned from materials of substance, bronze, marble, stone. Serious material for serious works by worthy subjects. And if there's one word that might be used in relation to a suit these days, it could be formal. And this is a word with great importance and significance to Edward Wurm. Austrian artist Edward Wurm was born at Wurm an der Mur in Styria, Austria, 1954. He lives and works between Vienna and Limburg. In 1977, he graduated from the University of Graz in Austria, also the Gestaltungslehre, University of Applied Art and Academy of Fine Art in Vienna, 1982. And he was one of the Austrian representatives to the Venice Biennale in 2017. His work, Half Big Suit, made of lacquer aluminum in 2016, is located in 777 East Wisconsin Avenue. And over the years, Wurm has been the subject of numerous museum exhibitions. He's also part of many institutional. And suits have been part of his body of work for several years. In the late 1980s, early 1990s, he produced his one-minute figures and one-minute sculptures. It's right very simple. So he produced these one-minute figures, one-minute sculptures. And these were figurative works involving himself, a model, or a member of the public, and documented through photographs, drawings, and video. The protagonist, no matter who it might be, was asked to interact with an everyday object in a designated manner. Thus, the human basically became the sculpture just as the object did too. But sculpture, to a certain extent, always implies stasis, a monument, a remembrance, a night of their permanence. And Wurm's woman and sculptures really rejected this in the extreme, with humans interacting with the object for a mere 60 seconds. And when you look at these things, you really couldn't actually, I don't think, hold any of these particular poses for more than 60 seconds. In. But in 2016, Wurm began his Verschnitt sculpturing series, and that went on to have a direct correlation to half mixed soot. These are miniature versions from which half-baked soup would spring. The smaller versions of these sculptures measure, on the left you've got the small version, on the right you've got the Wisconsin-Avenue version. The small version measures about 18 inches, by about 10 inches, by about 5 inches. So, and it's certainly appropriate for a small gallery or a domestic location, but obviously it would not have the gravitas to be put outside. And in this series of 11 sculptures, Wurm employed traditional figurative sculpture medium, bronze, but he unconventionally painted it with paint rather than using a traditional patina. And he also adopted a technique of taking the figural form apart only to reassemble it haphazardly, so we still get the gist of his motives, which is to inject a sense of playfulness into his work, which is quite deliberate and conscious. And in an interview, Wurm said, if you approach things with a sense of humor, people immediately assume you're not to be taken seriously. But I think truths about society and humanist existence can be approached in different ways. You don't always have to be deadly serious. Sarcasm and humor can help you see things in a lighter vein. And as we've seen, most public figures of sculpture is meant to be taken very seriously. And this is another picture of another Wurm work. It's on a very traditional plinth. It's in St. Louis. It's from 2011. And in this case, Wurm also plays with scale. The most figures of sculpture is somewhat larger than life, but this particular sculpture would be the equivalent of a size 144, if it was actually a real human being. And the orthodox placement of this particular piece is in a park, it's on a plinth, of an unorthodox or unconventional sculpture. It's really reminiscent somewhat of the fourth plinth debate in London's Trafalgar Square. London's Trafalgar Square, there are four plinths, three of which are sculptures on them. The fourth plinth in the northwest corner, which was designed by Sir Charles Barry, it was built in 1841, was intended to hold an equestrian sculpture, William IV, but it remained empty due to insufficient funds, which is kind of interesting. 1841 wasn't like long time. In 2005, the Fourth Plinth Commission was established, led by the Mayor of London's culture team under the guidance of the Fourth Plinth Commissioning. All credit must really be given to the group who seized the opportunity to open up the debate about what appropriate public sculpture should be, particularly in such a historic, high-profile location such as Trafalgar Square. And ever since then, non-traditional, unconventional sculptures have been temporarily placed on the fourth plinth. This is Mark Quinn's Alison Lapper Pregnant from 2005. It's 12 feet tall, it's 13 tons, it's Carrara marble, it's a torso bust of Alison Lapper, an artist who has worn no arms and shortened legs. And it really explores the representations of beauty, the human form in public space, and it was actually made even larger for the closing ceremony. Summer Paralympic Games. Michael Elmgren and Ingar Drags at Powerless Structures, figure 101 from 2012. So this is a 13 foot tall bronze sculpture of a boy in the Rocky Mountains. So contrasting it with the square's other statues with celebrated kings, military leaders, this commission was intended to portray the heroism of growing up. To me, it's also marvelous in that it mimics the tradition of equestrian sculpture. The other sculptures in Trafalgar Square is an equestrian sculpture of George IV, and so I think it's great that you could have a child on a rocking horse on the feet. And speaking of horses, Hans Hack, Gift Horse, 2015, and here you've got the skeletal riderless horse. And Hack says that the sculpture is a tribute to the Scottish economist Adam Smith and the English painter George Stubbs. And the horse is based on an engraving by Stubbs. 9 that have been there have opened up the debate about public sculpture in a way that the existing sculptures of Henry Havelock, Charles James Napier, and Charles IV do not. In fact, they're almost invisible due to their permanence and the lack of identification and knowledge of the subjects. I mean, there's text on the plinth there, and it's not exactly extended, it doesn't exactly explain a great deal about who these particular men were. For your information, Sir Henry Havelock, 1795 to 1857, was a British general who was particularly associated with India and the recapture of Cawnpore during the Indian Rebellion of 1857. Sir James Napier, 1782 to 1853, was an officer in a veteran of the British Army's Peninsula and 1812 campaigns, and later a major general of the Bombay Army. He also led the military conquest of Sindh province. He was the governor of Sindh, commander-in-chief in India. And then we've had George IV, otherwise known as George Augustus Frederick, 1762 to 1830. He was the king of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Ireland, and king of Hanover, following the death of his father, King George III. In other words, these three sculptures are all rather predictable in that they feature old, dead, white men of high ranking status who in a contemporary light are at least guilty of cultural suppression and colonialism. But together, they really reflect much of what is wrong, or at least out of date, with a lot of figures in public sculpture today. Knowledge and recognition of subjects has vanished into history, and their seeming kind of ubiquity has meant that the public pays them scant attention. On the other hand, by the regular changing of the sculpture of the fourth plinth, just like sculpture of Milwaukee does on Wisconsin Avenue, it keeps the debate about public sculpture fresh, topical, and contemporary. And Wurm's half-big suit in Milwaukee contradicts the convention of figurative sculpture and its strong tendency to focus on the great and the good and the male and the white. Half-big suit is at once male, yet inconclusive as to race or nationality. It is the everyman, so long as that everyman wears a suit. But as we know, not every man wears a suit. In fact, not every man nowadays owns a suit, but every man could own a suit, hence its point of connection. And the placement of half-big suit is basically perfect. It's in the central business district of Milwaukee. The sculpture is placed right opposite the older, more formal headquarters of Ralph Weston Mitchell. And how appropriate in the world of insurance that a suit should be there. It's located near banks and law offices, professions that still require certain formality, a certain conventionality, a dress code. After all, a meeting with one's accountant, lawyer, and insurance agent might not go well if they dress like an off-duty Boris Johnson. But Wurm does get unconventional. The suit is empty. Is he suggesting that the power of the ubiquitous business suit was lost some of its power? Certainly, the contrast between the old, formal Northwestern building and in the background you can kind of see it's the newer iteration. More modern labor could not be more subtle. Wurm's articulation also rejects the staid historical stereotypes that might have been engendered by its location. This sculpture is not just about casual Friday, not about the end of the work week to cut loose and metaphorically kick up one's heels. But to analyze this deeper, technology and computers have reduced the workforce of such companies as Northwestern Mutual. Real formalities are slowly eroding. I know several senior insurance companies executives who I spent, I've known them for 10, 15 years. They almost always wear sport coats, open neck shirts, no ties. If you ever see them in a tie or suit tie, it's unusual. And these are basically the top CEOs of the country. And so a suit and a tie is as if acknowledging not just the transition of clothing, but business in with the old, out with the new. And Wurm also plays on the formal nature of the suit and its identification with masculinity. Think old school insurance man, you think somber, gray suited hair. In Wurm's interpretation and coloration, he uses pink, a color often affiliated with more feminine attributes or stereotyping, maybe suggestive of more casual, modern attitudes and gender assigned colors. And finally, there are 32 sponsors for character tradition. Whereas their new tower suggests a more contemporary, relaxed dress code, something clearly expressed by Wurm's articulation and cognition. And finally, as soon as I saw this sculpture by Edward Wurm, I quickly cast my mind back to simpler times. A sponsorship of the arts was a less complicated, less time-consuming activity. Back in the day, you made your appointment, funder, you showed up, you made your pitch, got the money, all for those halcyon days. So I'm going to leave you with this. This is what I thought of when I first saw it. Monty Python's Ministry of Sidewalks. I challenge you, I dare you to not think of the Wurm sculpture and how it marvelously explores the status of what clothes can convey and juxtaposes the epitome of conventionality and unconventionality.
I'm a search fellowship at the end of Bridge City Book. I marshal you to your Absolutely.